On April 29th, I embarked on the Carnival Horizon from Miami, Florida, for an 8-day Southern Caribbean cruise with port stops in Aruba, Bonaire, and Curaçao, also known as the ABC Islands. Here's a little snip of my week. Carnival Horizon is the 26th ship in the Carnival fleet. The Horizon took its maiden voyage in April of 2018. There are 15 decks, 1,967 cabins, and can accommodate 4,977 guests plus 1,450 crew members. Here is a view of the beautiful Miami skyline. This is my home away from home for the next 8 nights, a standard balcony cabin. Carnival prides themselves on being the fun ships, and the sail away parties never disappoint. Doesn't this get you in the mood for cruising? With over 15 dining venues, you will never go hungry. Next is a sampling of some of the amazing meals I had. There are over 13 bars on board, so you will never go thirsty. Next is a tiny sampling of the amazing onboard live entertainment.
the shine of a thousand spotlights. All the stars are steal from the night sky. Will never be enough. Never be enough. Towers of gold are still too little. These sands could hold the world, but it'll never be enough.
There is an IMAX theater and Thrill Theater on board. For those of you who like games of chance, there's an adult arcade on board. As you can see, Lightning Cash was pretty good to me. The entertainers are not the only talented ones. My cabin attendant left me these really cute towel animals every day. This itinerary included 4 sea days and 3 port days. This is what it looks like when you are out at sea. There is nothing for miles, and it is the most spectacular view. Just look at this beautiful sunset. Land ho! Aruba straight ahead. It's almost time to get off the ship and do some exploring. The Cuckoo Canuku Excursion, an open-air bus that took us to a few points of interest. There was music and singing and dancing and maracas. It was fun. And we learned a little bit about Aruba.
Woo!
the original house built on Aruba. It's still owned by the same family today. The house was constructed with limestone, and cactus was used for wood in place of trees. This is the Alto Vista Chapel. This chapel was built in 1750 with the hopes of converting the local Indians into the Catholic faith. This is known to be the first church in Aruba. Alto Vista means high views, as this was built up high in the hills. The views are quite spectacular. The chapel is still used as a place of worship. On Good Friday, local Catholics will make a 6-mile pilgrimage on foot from Aranjestad, the capital of Aruba, to the chapel to perform the Stations of the Cross. The California Lighthouse was built in 1916 on the northwest tip of Aruba. The lighthouse is named after the SS California, which sunk nearby prior to its construction. And the last stop was Eagle Beach for a little relaxing, sunning, and swimming. After a full day of excursion and shopping, it was time to stop at Lucy's by the water for a beverage and a snack with a great view. Did you know Aruba is a desert island? The landscape is quite barren, with the exception of many cactus plants. Palm trees that you see in the resort areas are not native. They were brought there to give the island a more tropical feel. Aruba is a constituent country of the Kingdom of the Netherlands. Aruba is located just 18 miles north of Venezuela. The island of Aruba is only 20 miles long and 6 miles wide. Our next port stop is Bonaire. Bonaire is an island in the Dutch Caribbean, about 86 miles east of Aruba and 50 miles north of Venezuela. Bonaire is one of the best scuba diving destinations in the world because of their pristine waters and government-protected coral reefs. On Bonaire, I rented a golf cart and toured the northern and southern parts of the island. My tour starts with the Northern Loop. The first stop on my little journey is a beach and shore dive area called the Thousand Steps. This very long, rugged stone staircase leads you to a beautiful beach known for shore, scuba diving, and snorkeling. While there are only really 50 to 60 steps in reality, it's called a Thousand Steps because that's how many it feels like for the divers making the climb back up with all of their diving equipment. Our next stop is Carpata. On one side of the road, there's a shore dive area, and on the other side of the road is Plantation Carpata. Plantation Carpata is the ruins of an old aloe plantation from the 19th century. The building was repurposed for other uses in more recent times, but is now abandoned. Next, we come to the Marine Reserve. Swimming, boating, snorkeling, or diving are not allowed in this area. Bonaire's government is very big on reef preservation and therefore has one of the healthiest and most beautiful reefs in the world. One of my favorite stops was the Flamingo Sanctuary. Bonaire is one of the very few places in the world that the American flamingo will breed. Breeding season is from January through July, so I was there at the perfect time to see some babies. You might have seen some gray flamingos in those pictures. Well, those are the babies. They are not born pink. Their rich diet of brine shrimp is how they get their pink color. The town of Rincon was established in 1527 by the Spanish. Rincon is the oldest settlement in the Dutch Caribbean. It's surrounded by hills, being hidden from pirates, and they had access to fresh water to allow for agriculture. Bon Bini means welcome in the Papiamento language. I made a new friend. Wild donkey are everywhere on this island. I'll give you more history about the wild donkey later in this presentation. While in Rincon, a stop at the Kadushi Distillery is a must. This small distillery makes rum and other liquors out of cactus. Since I was driving a rented golf cart on some really rough terrain, I opted to not do the liquor tasting. But I did enjoy the adorable courtyard filled with local birds and iguanas. The last stop on the northern tour was a drive up to Siru Lagu, which means large hill. I drove my little putt-putt golf cart up a steep one-way road on the side of a cliff to get here. It was terrifying, but oh my gosh, was it worth it? Look at that view. You can see the cruise ship from here. Oh, and I made another new little friend. Now it's time for the Southern Loop. We stopped at this cute little beach on the side of the road for some snorkeling. Getting in the water was a little difficult because of all the coral, so water shoes are definitely a must when visiting Bonaire. I would like to interrupt this peaceful snorkel to remind you I am not a professional underwater photographer. Thank you. Thank you. Continuing south, you will come to the salt ponds. Bonaire is a major producer of pure sea salt that is exported all over the Caribbean, North America, and Europe. This solar salt facility is currently owned by Cargill. The production of sea salt is very scientific, but basically the water is pumped from the ocean and then the water evaporates. As the water evaporates, the salt crystallizes. Once all of the water evaporates, the salt is collected and placed into giant pyramids, as you might see in the background. And then it's moved onto shipping freights from there. Hey, that water's pink. How is the water pink? Well, the water gets its pink color from a microorganism that thrives in the brine. For more information on the history and production of Bonaire sea salt, please visit BonaireSeaSalt.com. I could do a whole presentation on this alone, but I only have so much time. This is the salt pier. Freight ships pull up to this pier, and the salt is then pumped from the salt mountains into the ships. This is also a very popular spot for snorkeling and scuba diving. Just a short distance from the salt pans, you will come across the slave huts. The inscription on the monument reads, "These huts were constructed in 1850 during the slave time and served as camping facilities for slaves working in these salt ponds to collect and ship the salt, one of Bonaire's most important export products. These huts were used as sleeping quarters and a place to put away personal belongings of the working teams. Up to 6 men shared each of these huts during the week. And on the weekends, they would make the trek to Rincon on foot to spend time with their families. This trek could take up to 10 hours. Slavery was abolished on Bonaire in 1863. These huts still stand today as a reminder of Bonaire's dark past. Now let's talk about my new friends. Donkeys were brought to Bonaire by the Spanish settlers in the 17th century to be used for hard labor. Once modern transportation was introduced, the donkeys were just left to roam the island freely, and they still do to this day. They are everywhere. Due to the year-long trade winds, Bonaire is a premier spot for kiteboarding and windsurfing. Professionals from all over the world come to Bonaire for training and competitions. As you can see here, the ocean gets a little angrier the more south you go. This is the Willem Storen Lighthouse. Right next door is the abandoned lightkeeper's house. Our tour of Bonaire ends at Sorbon Beach in the Lac Bay area for a little relaxing and cooling off after a long hot day. This is a view of the port from my balcony. Our last and final port stop, Curaçao. Unfortunately, our stay in Curaçao was the shortest of the three port stops, so there really wasn't a lot of time to really take in all the island has to offer. The day started with a trip to Blue Bay Beach for some tanning, swimming, and snorkeling. Next, a walk through the capital city of Willemstad to visit the Queen Emma Bridge. This is a pontoon bridge that connects the Punda and Outrabanda quarters of Willemstad. The bridge opens to allow for boats to pass through the Santa Ana Bay. The water was a little rough that day and the bridge was a rockin'. I tried to get close to the edge to get a close-up picture of the pontoons, but my phone and I almost landed in the bay. On the Punda side of Willemstad is an art piece by Carlos Blocker called Punda Love Hearts. Couples who travel to Curaçao will clip a padlock to it to seal their love bond. I did not. Maybe someday. This is the Riff Fort area. The fort was originally built in 1828 to protect Curaçao from invaders. It now serves as a multi-purpose entertainment area with shops, bars, restaurants, and it's attached to the Renaissance Hotel. This is Chichi. Sculptures like this can be found all around Curaçao, decorated all differently. Chichi is the loving household name for the eldest sister in the traditional Curaçao family structure. Chichi is an expression of big love and big care. Artist Serena Israel and her team give homage to these soulful eldest sisters in Curaçao's culture. Curaçao is home to two bridges of notoriety. This is the Queen Juliana Bridge, a four-lane bridge that stands at 185 feet above the water, making it the highest bridge in all of the Caribbean. It was built high enough to allow smaller cruise ships and cargo ships to pass beneath. The best way to end your port day is to stand on your balcony and wait for pier runners. If you don't get back to the ship at full board time, they will leave you. Run, Forrest, run! So where to next? Well, on September 24th, I will embark on this big girl, the Carnival Celebration. She is currently Carnival's newest and largest ship in the fleet. This will be a 7-day trip with ports of call in Amber Cove, Dominican Republic, San Juan, Puerto Rico, and St. Thomas, U.S. Virgin Islands. Do you want to come with me? Thank you for allowing me the opportunity to share a little bit of my journey with you. This was by far my most favorite cruise and ports of call. I hope you enjoyed this, and I hope you learned a little something about islands you may or may not have heard of before.